It felt like a hurricane.
There was just glass was shattered everywhere.
A truck jumped the curb and plowed through a Cape Coral pool hall, pinning people against the bar, killing one man and injuring three others.
I turned around to see a truck coming at me, and I'm lucky to be alive, actually.
NBC2 broke the story last night, bringing you a live report at 6 from Diamond Billiards on Pine Island Road. Tonight, we're learning more about the victims and how the crash happened. 60-year-old Ronald Gravel died. Three others were injured. NBC2's George Solis spoke to one of the victims who's in the ICU recovering. George?
From her hospital room, Tracy Booker tells me she remembers the moments before she and her roommate had been talking to the man at the bar here that would forever change their lives. Right now, the only evidence of that nightmare is the mapped out trajectory from police as that truck slammed into the pool hall, killing an innocent man in the process.
I'm lucky to be alive, actually.
From her hospital room in the ICU, Tracy Booker answered my call and immediately began talking about the moment that put her there in the first place.
Yeah, was telling us about Vietnam and stuff. We were talking about veterans, and then he left. And then he pulled back in and destroyed the place.
Police say that man is 75-year-old William Gulliver. According to investigators, Gulliver sat parked in front of the pool hall in his truck before driving through the building at a high rate of speed. The crash also killed longtime friend of the bar and kitchen manager, Ronald Gravel.
It's just unbelievable. I can't imagine what could have prompted somebody like that to, do something like that.
Today, the owner of Diamond Billiards tells us Gulliver had been kicked out of the bar for inappropriate behavior. And he said police found empty beer bottles in the truck. Police did cite alcohol as a factor in the crash.
It was like he had a fuse money.
Booker tells us her roommate, who was also injured in the wreck, questioned Gulliver's actions on the way to the hospital.
She asked him why he did it, and he said he didn't know.
Gulliver told us the same and adding his devastation for the loss of life. For Booker, it's a less than satisfactory answer.
Well, he just messed up a lot of people's lives because he didn't know.
Now, we have learned the other victim, Linda Gerard, was released from the hospital tonight. Family and friends of Ronald Gravel are asking for privacy as they mourn. And as you can see, there is a single bouquet here outside of the pool hall as friends and family mourn that loss tonight. Reporting live in Cape Coral, George Solis, NBC2.
Again, NBC2 spoke with the driver, William Gulliver, this afternoon. He didn't want to go on camera, but he claims this was an accident. Witnesses say Gulliver drove nearly 50 feet before he plowed to the back of the bar. We also talked with the owners of the pool hall. Again, they told us they asked Gulliver to leave minutes before the wreck.
It's so horrible. I mean, it's just, you wouldn't even think about having any, like, the dude is sitting at the bar. You wouldn't think about someone driving through the window and hitting him.
The owners say Gulliver had, again, two beers. Cape Coral police say alcohol was a factor, but so far no charges have been filed. The bar is expected to be closed for a few days.
She loved people, loved to talk, and a joker, and she loved her family.
Everybody misses her and wishes she was still here.
The family of a Fort Myers Shores woman will hold a candlelight vigil tonight after crews discovered her body in the Caloosahatchee. Chelsea Green was last seen Friday morning leaving a friend's house. Her family told us they were prepared for the worst after they received this text message that showed her GPS location just east of the Pygott Bridge, and that's where NBC2's Trent Kelly is right now. New at 6, you spoke with the fisherman who actually spotted another car, but that's what brought dive teams out to that location.
I did, Kelly. You know, this fisherman actually found out about Chelsea by watching the news. He says it was only because one of his daughters was actually friends with her that he decided to start his own search at a pond about a mile away from here. While he did end up finding a car there, it turned out not to belong to Chelsea. And it was later that same night that those divers from the Lee County Sheriff's Office made this heartbreaking discovery.
I could imagine. I have three daughters of my own. Imagine what parents would be going through, and siblings and friends.
It's that feeling that drove Scott Dunlap of Cape Coral to grab his fishing pole and a magnet and search this small body of water near the Lee County Civic Center yesterday.
Yeah, there wasn't a lot of effort being concentrated here. There was no effort that I seen at that point.
Dunlap called 911 after his magnet latched onto a submerged car. While it turned out not to belong to Chelsea Green, his efforts did get the dive team involved.
I heard a couple of them mention that they would continue searching this area then. I think so. You know, action gets reaction. And getting them out and getting them looking.
On the morning she went missing, Chelsea sent a GPS locator text to her brother, showing her as being just to the east of the Wilson-Pigott Bridge. According to Chelsea's family, her car was found in that same general area, submerged under the murky Caloosahatchee River.
Well, typically, you know, they would call 911 or the call the 9 emergency number. Either way, we would get an officer dispatched to the scene.
Deputies with the Lee County Sheriff's Office say every missing persons case begins with a report, which is later evaluated to determine if immediate action is necessary.
You may have people that we may actually put a press release out. That's going to be like missing endangered type of people or things that, you know, really kind of pique our interest.
In Chelsea's case, deputies made several passes from the air over the specific area mentioned in the text. But nothing was found. Now that her body has been recovered, Dunlap just hopes her family finds closure.
It breaks your heart. You know.
In less than an hour, friends and family of Chelsea will be gathering here next to the Pigott Bridge to honor her life and memory. The family has set up a memorial fund in Chelsea's name at all Regions Bank locations for anyone who is interested in helping out. Reporting live from Fort Myers Shores, Trent Kelly, NBC2.
Another inmate has died at the prison in Charlotte County. Robert Peterkin's death, one of six being investigated at the troubled prison. He was found dead shortly after he reported that a cell phone had been smuggled into the prison by guards. His family told only NBC2 that they think this is mysterious, although the warden told them he committed suicide.
He said that if anything ever happens to me here, you go after them, because, and exact words were, it will not be what it appears to be.
The Department of Corrections refuses to answer any questions about Peterkin's death. It comes on the heels of a grand jury investigation into another inmate's death. Matthew Walker died after being beaten by guards. NBC2 has learned the Charlotte Correctional Institution warden Thomas Reed is now being reassigned. He's going to take over another prison. He's being replaced by John Willis, who's currently the warden at a prison in the Panhandle. The Department of Corrections says this has nothing to do with the most recent death.
Almost 2 years after the murder of a Fort Myers man, his family just offered up an extra $2,000 in reward money to help keep the case from going cold. Kyle Burtis was killed in August of 2013. Deputies found his body in a Lehigh Acres field. Burtis was a track star at Fort Myers High School. He returned to the area after college on the East Coast. His family raised the money to add to the Crime Stoppers reward in hopes of catching his killer.
He was so young, he had such a great future, and for someone to take that at age 25, they need to pay a price for that.
Lamar Advertising also donated this billboard near the entrance of Pine Manor off US 41, the last area he was spotted before he died. They believe someone there may know something about his murder.
An 82-year-old woman who was hit by a golf cart in Lee County has died. Hazel Brideman was hit earlier this month at the Seven Lakes Golf and Tennis Club in South Fort Myers. Investigators say she was dragged nearly 30 feet. The driver of the golf cart, 97-year-old Julius Henley, told deputies that his 8-year-old great-grandchild was in the driver's seat while he controlled the pedals.
A violent case of road rage to tell you about in Lee County. Deputies arrested a man for pointing a gun at a Boquilla couple. It happened on Stringfellow Road. The couple says at first Russell Young laid on the horn, then got into the turn lane and pointed a gun at them. Young is accused of aggravated assault with a deadly weapon.
A warning tonight from the Department of Health: do not touch armadillos. Leprosy cases are on the rise, and experts say armadillos are to blame. So far this year, 9 cases have been reported in Florida. The CDC says armadillos are the only animal to carry leprosy, a disease that affects the skin and nerves.
1,000 new jobs are coming to Lee County.
I think we have a really fun culture. We have a very energetic culture.
New at 6, we're going to show you who's hiring and how job seekers can apply. Plus,
in the past, we might have seen one chihuahua a month. Now we're seeing 65 chihuahuas a month.
Overwhelmed by chihuahuas, the Naples Humane Society says they have too many of these tiny dogs. What may be causing the spike and the unique offer if you want to adopt them?
All right, Kelly, get ready. I'm about to geek out a little bit on the weather. She always likes it when I do this. Check a look at this. It's a freeze frame of a picture from this morning when the rain showers, very isolated showers, were starting to wash on shore. Look at the shape of the cloud right there. Did you see that? This is a classic example of what happens as showers develop and there's not enough wind aloft to push the cloud around. It literally just goes right straight up without any wind moving it around. Well, the time lapse shows you, though, it didn't last too long. Watch how it just kind of goes away as the winds kick up during the day. We've had weather like this all across Southwest Florida, very little rain, and I've got a forecast that still continues mainly dry in just a few minutes.